the clinical commissioning group governing body, which is a formal meeting held in public. This is slightly different today in that we have, this meeting is from now until 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock we will have our council colleagues from the joint strategic commissioning board. Ordinarily at the start of governing body we will invite 10 minutes of comments from our public. However, on this occasion we will do that at the start of the joint strategic commissioning board. So we will do that at 2 o'clock, if that's okay with everybody. So we have quite a tight time frame today. We just have an hour to go through our governing body, and so I'm going to be quite strict on times for those presenting papers.
financial performance for the commission as at the end of month two, which is the end of May. Year-to-date position is a deficit position of £2.4 million. As you know, when we submitted the financial plan at the start of the year, we determined that we were looking at a £14.6 million deficit, which was in line with our strategy to support primarily the acute trust with, in order to gain £20 million external funding. Officially, our control door is a balanced position, which would be balanced at £2.4 million adrift. The main reasons are around and set out on the introduction page in the bullet points and detailed more throughout the report. The prime rationale, the prime reason for our overspend is we know the unidentified quick savings of some £17 million. We started the original target 24, we identified 6.3, basically the £17 million is primarily the problem that we see now coming through the figures, and is likely to continue in the absence of anything else. The forecast to date, we're still officially forecast in line with Editors England principles or process about not being able to change the forecast. Future reports will include reports on our appendices on our performance as a system, which will be including WAF numbers and what their numbers do as in line with our strategy to make sure we're reporting Wirral system figures and not just CCG numbers. So happy to take any questions, Chair. At this stage, it's probably not a surprise. I would re-emphasise that over the last 3 years, we know our numbers, we know the risks, and basically this is an age-old problem of having a deficit where the regulators are not wanting to shift the control toward the recognition. My feeling is as at month 4 to 5, there will be further conversations and probably 6 or 7 a dawning on the regulators of the unavoidable nature of our deficit, in line with last year and previous years, as was our experience. So happy to take any questions, Chair.
Okay, thank you for that. Has anyone any comments, queries or questions regarding the financial report as at this moment? No? Great. Thank you. Moving on then, Alan. Thanks.
I might just say a very brief summary of the report of the Finance Committee meeting held on the 30th of April. I think the two things I wanted to highlight, showing on the key issue stroke messages section 2, are firstly the success in delivering the statutory financial duties for the last financial year, 2018/19, which has now been audited and signed off by the governing body. In May. And I do think, in spite of the news that we've just heard from Mike about the current financial year, it's just worth recording the governing body's appreciation of those results, given that it's the first time, I think, for about 3 or 4 years that we've managed to deliver a financial surplus of income over expenditure, notwithstanding that there was some help from NHS England. too much to say that the meeting in May was looking at the very early performance figures for the new financial year, only based on 1 month's information, and really I think the report will stand as presented. And from what my office tells about half two, the position has remained fairly consistent following the pattern we expected. This was the traditional long meeting of the Audit Committee because it was essentially receiving a number of year-end reports from various sources as well as agreeing the audit plan for the work for the committee for the new year. So we did take the opportunity at that meeting to review the annual report and accounts in some detail, and I reported back on that at the last governing body meeting at the end of May. We had a presentation from Simon regarding the annual governance statement and presentations from our auditors on the work that they had done. And the outcome of that meeting broadly was to commend to the governing body the adoption of the annual report and the accounts and the receipt of the reports both from the internal and external auditors. And that did happen, so this report is a little bit behind time now, but for the record, that was the main business of the meeting.
Thanks. Any questions from the public?
I think I can relax now.
Sorry?
I think I can relax now.
Yeah, you can reserve now. You're awesome. Great. Excellent. Moving on to performance and commissioning innovation, and that's the Director of Commissioning to give us an update on that.
Thanks, Chair. I'll take it that everybody's read the paper, and I'm very conscious of time, so I'll just look at some key areas really. And one area I did want to cover was the development of primary care networks on Wirral, which I think is a really key development that we've got, and it's really exciting times for primary care. So this is part of the new five-year GP contract that's come out from NHS England, and it's for a national, it's called the Direct Enhanced Service, for GPs to join the primary care network, and they all started on the 1st of July, so last Monday. On Wirral we had several meetings to agree what our PCNs would look like for primary care networks, and it's really great to, you know, that on Wirral we've got 100% coverage, so all of our practices are covered, and they're all within a primary care network, so that's brilliant. When they've started now, their first job is to look at an extended hours national enhanced service, and also to look at employing a clinical pharmacist and also a social prescriber link worker as well. Next year there's a lot more asks for them, and they've got five new service specifications which are outlined in the paper, and it's a really good place for primary care to be. They're going to have a lot more support, and I think those are just really key for us in terms of how we deliver against the outcomes that we want for the population of Wirral. So I think it's a really exciting time. In terms of the performance, so if we just go through some of the highlight ones. So for A&E in March and April this year, you can see there that we didn't meet the national standard, and we were performing either 76.69% or 73.57%. More recently, the performance has improved, which is really good. And you can see some of the actions highlighted in the paper of all of the mitigations that have been undertaken and the progress since my last paper to the governing body. And priorities are also highlighted there. In terms of ambulance, which is also very closely related to A&E, you can see that we've achieved two of the six ambulance response performance. And that's continuing to improve, and that's really key for us. Alongside that, the ambulance handover, as a result of some changes that Arrow Park have done within the hospital, we are now achieving the 30-minute handover from when an ambulance arrives to when they actually leave the hospital. And again, that's having an excellent outcome in terms of ambulances. thing to note is that our GP referrals are down below the plan at month 12. And again, that's really positive because that means that people are not being referred that don't need to be referred to the hospital. So that's really good news for everybody as well. The cancer one, we've passed the majority of them, and you can see the ones there that we failed to do. We're continuing to work tirelessly on improving our cancer pathways. And the latest thing is that we've got a new 2-week wait that's been launched for the prostate cancer referrals as well, which is having a really positive impact on the patient's experience as well. The last one is access to psychological therapy, so to talking therapies. So everybody will be aware that from April, a new provider has taken over, and some of the issues are highlighted there in terms of that transition from the old provider to the new provider. The new provider is working really hard to address the issues that were left with them, and we still have our trajectory for full recovery by quarter three of this year as well. Okay, I'm happy to take any questions if anybody's got any.
Claire, thanks. Just one question, just that you need to keep an eye on the AME performance because the great news of the ambulance handovers are now within time and ambulances have been freed up. But if we don't see improvement in the A&E performance, then we've actually just treated another kid, so we need to make sure that's been driven forward to improve them.
Thanks, Mike, and that's a really good question. And just to really show, the 4-hour target has also improved as well. So it's really great news.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions?
Two quick points. The first one is to acknowledge the improvement from 111, because I think I've commented in the past on the fact that their performance has been fairly static and below expectations for some time. So to see those steep rises in the curves for performance is very reassuring. The other point I was going to ask is the disappointing handover of the IAPT services to the new provider that's left operational problems in terms of catching up with a backlog of work. I just wondered if we had any recourse to the original providers for their poor performance in the latter part of the contract.
Thanks, Alan. And yes, it is disappointing because despite some very close working with the outgoing provider, there was this discovery after they'd gone. We have been in touch with the regulators because obviously we don't have a contract with them as such at the moment, but the regulators are aware.
Fine, thank you.
Thanks, Alan. Just on 111, again, yeah, just to reiterate the improvement in trajectories and on target for some of the key performance indicators, and to acknowledge the work that Sarah Jake has put into this, one of our commissioning leads, and she presented recently at Wirral. Thank you.
key issues that if we get some of the basics right, we could actually make an impact really quite quickly. I think the other thing for me is that this is a whole system approach, so it's not just about what's happening in the hospital or in the community trust, it's also about how we work with both primary care and with the general public. So we've got a very small team working on this, I think working extremely hard, but I would like to see that this comes back on a regular basis to your body, just so that we make sure that profile is kept around some really key issues for us.
Thank you. I acknowledge that, I think we will continue to monitor this. As I say, it's a key area for us to address, and it should be given the same airspace as some other agenda items. Alex?
Yes, I just wanted to thank the page on that, to share my concern about the rapid rise in CDF rates that we're seeing around the place. And, one thing which I think these graphs don't show us is the resistance rates within CDF. There's a particular resistant strain that is so prevalent at the moment that I've had advice from a microbiologist that we should just assume that the current case that I'm dealing with is the resistant strain, so we have to give extremely high potency antibiotics. There's no new antibiotics on the horizon being developed, so this is a potential huge issue for us. I think one thing that we do struggle with in the community is knowing absolutely for sure when to give antibiotics or not, because obviously the less antibiotics we give, the less likely we're going to get C. diff. And the trouble with that is that you don't want the patient to suffer with an infection that could have got better with the antibiotics. We need to be looking at whether there are measures that can be done within the practice, perhaps through networks, to rapidly assist in diagnosing things.
Just to come back, so you're absolutely right, we do have a particularly aggressive, which is 027, is the strain of C. diff. I suppose my challenge back, and this is what's doing three or four simple things will actually stop it from happening in the first place, and that's good hand hygiene and washing hands. It's around wearing PPE, which is protective equipment and clothing, and also making sure that your estate is clean, so and the equipment that you use is clean as well. By good clean facilities, that could actually stop it in the first place, and I think that's where we need to get to. We need to be doing some of the basics brilliantly, and I don't think we're there either yet. So therefore, you're absolutely right. We end up with C. difficile, and we're going to treat that rather than actually prevent it in the first place. Good point.
Simon.
So between Julie and that, Laura captured many of the points that I wanted to make around the importance of this in terms of the wider piece around resistance to antibiotics. We're hearing that people some of the higher doses of antibiotics are more strong ones than we're starting as a society to lose our ability to treat many things, which is quite worrying. And as we know, we're saying as pharmaceutical companies don't seem to be in the pipeline for making any more antibiotics fairly soon, so there's nothing on the horizon. We heard this morning from the Hospital Trust some of this is also about high levels of bed occupancy, but also it's down to the basics of hand hygiene, protective equipment, and making sure that the environment is generally clean, because they are places for which there can be direct and indeed direct contact from in terms of infection prevention and control. Judy did bring this to us and to Healthy Wirral some time ago as a system-wide issue. As we've now seen it twice, I would expect the third time for assurance for us, we actually, this is a really helpful report, perhaps it can be developed next time in terms of the, like we said, we're going to do this. What's the progress been on it? So we said we're going to have a communication plan about hydration. What does it look like? And we demonstrated with the patient story the
seen as a just something that Julian Lawler do, but it's actually, it is key as part of the commissioning of services that, that we do. So we can absolutely bring that assurance back. There's probably something I need to say in this, I believe.